数年前的金融危机让人们再一次见识到了美国纽约这条500米长的狭长街道的影响力。有人说呢，这可能是一种无与伦比的影响，因为在这条街道上的任何一点风吹草动都有可能像蝴蝶效应一样来牵动全世界最敏感的经济神经。不过不可否认呢，华尔街创造财富的能力远远大过于它对于财富的破坏。今天即将来到我们对话节目现场的这位嘉宾，就以他特有的创造财富的能力被称作是这个时代的华尔街之王。我们来看看屏幕上出现的这些品牌：乐高玩具、杜莎夫人蜡像馆、爱马仕、范思哲，这些在世界上很有影响力的品牌相信您都非常的熟悉。但是我在猜，也许你并不知道在这些品牌的背后都有这位华尔街之王的身影。这位华尔街之王曾经给自己开了一个年薪数字，让很多人都又羡慕又嫉妒，因为他给自己开的年薪是1年7亿美金。哇，那么他创造财富的秘诀到底是什么？今天这位华尔街之王已经来到了中国，来到了中央电视台，在30秒钟之后他就会走进我们的演播现场，为大家一一的来揭晓这些。好，现在我们就请出黑石集团的共同创始人、全球主席兼首席执行官史蒂夫·施瓦茨曼先生，欢迎他。
欢迎您。你好。哦。
很多人没有去过华尔街，我们都是对华尔街有很多的想象，包括通过一些影视作品来了解。比如说呢，在我的记忆当中就有这样的三部跟华尔街有关的电影特别的出名。这是1987年出品的华尔街，这个迈克尔·道格拉斯当时还拿到了奥斯卡的最佳男主角。然后第二部电影呢是2010年的华尔街金钱未眠。然后2013年，哇，小李那个时候还是很帅啊，华尔街之狼。
1987年，好莱坞经典影片《华尔街》以华尔街为背景，描写贪婪成性的股市大亨操纵股票行情，结果败给一位具有良知的年轻营业员的故事。其中贪婪是好东西这句台词已经成为经典名言。2010年的续集《华尔街金钱永不眠》则讲述上一部影片的主人公独行欺瞒，准备重新投身到华尔街，但很快发现这个华尔街比当年更加贪婪和凶险。而2013年的《华尔街之狼》讲述华尔街的一位股票经纪人游走在法律边缘的发家生涯，以及迷失于性和毒品的沉沦生活。
所有的跟华尔街想象当中的一些东西都来自于电影。你看过这三部电影吗？你觉得电影描述的华尔街跟你真实工作当中的华尔街是一样的吗？
Actually, the best of these three movies, I think, was the 1987 original Wall Street movie with Michael Douglas. And that actually was a part of us. It was like a small part of takeovers in Wall Street. The second movie, and I'm not normally a movie critic, the second movie was a bit of a rerun of, which wasn't so interesting. The third movie, The Wolf of Wall Street, was actually completely unrepresentative of anything that was going on. I've been doing this type of work of investing in Wall Street for over 40 years, and I never even heard of this guy, you know, Jordan Belfort.
但是在这样的一个影片当中，人们似乎读到了几个关键词。
And I'd also say, he ended up in jail for a really good reason. He was a criminal, and this is totally unlike normal types of adult behavior.
这个影片好像让人们看到了在华尔街工作的人身上都有的一些特点，你比如说什么投机啊，什么贪婪啊等等，这都是影片传递出来的信息。
Someone reminded me the other evening that I once said greed is good. Now it seems it's legal.
most people on Wall Street are nice people, they're educated people, they're hardworking people. Mm-hmm. And part of the function of Wall Street is to take savings of people and invest them and give those people who gave you the savings a return on their money and to keep it safe.
Churchill Schwartz, off the floor!
They're creating rumors around the hydro position. None of it's true. They're just trying to kill the stock.
Doesn't make any difference.
That's what they're after. They're after Churchill, which has a big position in the stock, because Churchill got the sweetheart deal on television.
Churchill's forces have 5% position.
Who knows? Who's got the inside line on some Timbuktu?
Almost every developed country and most developing countries that you need some, in effect, opportunity for capital to go someplace and have somebody do something to it that's productive.
当然这是华尔街之王说出来的华尔街印象。华尔街之王不是我们给你的称号，而是美国财富杂志上有一年的封面曾经给你的称号。
华尔街之王史蒂夫·施瓦茨曼拥有全球最大的私募股权公司黑石，管理超过2700亿美元资产。而30年前组建黑石时，他仅仅投资20万美元。在过去30年间，黑石平均年收益率高达33%，施瓦茨曼也成为年薪7亿美元的投资巨鳄，被称为华尔街的新国王。
但是，好像从你的表情里看出，你也没太多的喜悦，也不太 care 有这样的一个光环或者是一个王冠戴在你的头上。
Well, that was a bit of an odd picture of me. They asked me to not smile, and as you can probably see, that's not typical of me. Because that was 8 years ago, and we all lived through the financial crisis, that made you a little older. And fortunately for Blackstone, which is my company, we did extremely well during that period.
但是旁边的描述，我觉得恐怕是你的非常典型的风格。大家看一下哈，Steve， 他想要买你的公司，因为他有1250亿的美金可以来做这样的事儿。
Our company has done very well, and you know I own about 22% of our company, so I've not done so badly. But the important thing is what we do, and what we do is we basically invest money from all over the world and try and make very high returns. Yeah.For our investors. So we've averaged around 10% more than the stock market. Now that's a lot. And because of that, people give us more and more money. And what we try and do is we buy companies, we buy real estate, and we fix them up. Yeah. We make them better. We make better products. And as a result, when we sell them, there's more earnings,and people pay us a higher multiple because the companies are growing faster. So it's what we call in English a virtuous circle where everyone wins.
Yeah.
I guess in Chinese you call it a win-win situation.
合作共赢是吧？双赢。OK. 所以你看到提到了投资，提到了回报，提到了挣钱，他的眼中熠熠发光，这才是一个更加典型的 Steve 的形象啊！来，我们掌声欢迎你入座，谢谢。来，刚才也提到了黑石的投资，提到了他们的挣钱，但我不知道你介意不介意，在今天的节目当中，我把坊间对你的收入的传言透露一下，他们说。你去年拿的工资就有7亿美金啊。
Apparently that's true. But the reason that happens isn't because a company pays me an income. I have worked for, by Wall Street standards, a low income, which is $350,000, and all the rest of the money I get is really from dividends. I'd just be treated like everyone else.
Yeah.
The only difference is I work about 14 hours a day to get that. And if you owned... And if you owned our stock, you wouldn't have to work at all. So maybe I've got a bad deal. But I love working at Blackstone.
实际上，英雄也常常都有走背字儿的时候。比如说，金融危机来临的时候，谁都难以逃脱这个厄运。对黑石来说，当时裁员的人也特别多，多达100多人。然后在2009年，黑石的股价降到谷底的时候，比峰值大概跌去了90%。然后您自己在那两年，当然没有拿到我们所说的7亿美金的年薪，而只是拿到了35万的一个底薪。
The financial crisis was a very unusual period. I've experienced declines, and the way we set our business up was to basically make it pretty bomb-proof. From the difficulties that other people have. We don't have deposits, so nobody can take their money away, which is one of the problems during the financial crisis. And we don't have to sell at bottoms. In fact, we bought when other people were selling. And so for us, we just had to be patient.
美国为什么经济从2008年之后恢复得这么快？应该在很大程度上是应该归功于华尔街的一大批公司，尤其是像黑石这种公司。
对，
为什么这么讲？因为量化宽松政策推出来之后，央行印了很多钞票，这个钞票啊交给了银行，商业银行，商业银行不敢花，怎么办？就交给了黑石这样的公司。黑石的公司干什么呢？用这些新来的资金去买当时估价非常低的很多资产，包括房地产。通过这种运营，就把量化宽松政策的像个发动机一样，把它传递到轮子了，车轮子了。它是一个中间的传动器。为什么欧洲这么慢还没恢复？就是因为它没有这套市场的机制。所以我愿意讲，就是华尔街包括黑石这种公司，事实上是这一轮美国经济恢复中的一个大家没有看到的一个重要的一个要素。
但是去年呢，美国就已经退出了量化宽松的这个政策。随着这个政策的退出，我们现在看到很多的投资者并没有那么大的意向和愿望把自己的钱投在新兴市场上，但是我们自己可以想办法自筹资金来自救。我们看到就在不久之前呢，亚洲基础设施投资银行开始频频的出现在公众和媒体的视野当中。这应该就是说以中国主导的，我们联合了很多亚洲的小伙伴共同打造的一个机构。
今年3月以来，亚投行的关注度在全球呈爆发式上涨。截至目前，提出申请以意向创始成员国身份加入亚投行的国家和地区总数已达52个，其中31个国家已成为正式的意向创始成员国。2013年10月，习近平主席和李克强总理在先后出访东南亚时，提出了筹建亚洲基础设施投资银行及亚投行的倡议。2014年10月24号，中国、印度、马来西亚、新加坡、泰国、乌兹别克斯坦、越南等首批21个意向创始成员国在北京签约，决定成立亚投行。2014年11月27号和12月31号，印度尼西亚和马尔代夫分别成为第22和第23个意向创始成员国。2015年3月12号，英国成为第一个申请加入亚投行的主要西方国家。3月17号，法国、德国和意大利均同意效仿英国申请加入亚投行。从3月26号到31号，加入亚投行形成一波井喷。在短短6天中，亚投行迎来了巴西、俄罗斯、韩国、澳大利亚、丹麦、荷兰、格鲁吉亚、奥地利等一长串国家争相加入朋友圈。与此同时，世界第一大经济体美国对待中国主导的亚投行的态度始终受到世界的重点关注。但对于这样一个能带来共荣的多边机构，很长一段时间以来，美国对于加入亚投行迟迟没有给出反应。那么美国的这种态度到底是为什么？将来美国又将做出什么选择？
Well, first of all, I'm not a US government spokesman. I'm just a person.
美国并没有改变他的主意，但是他曾经说服过的一些欧洲盟友说，哎，你们不要参加亚投行了。有不少人却已经改变了主意，已经加入到中国主导的亚洲基础设施投资银行当中了。那么未来美国到底会有什么样的一些抉择呢？来，我们大家不妨来做一个猜测哈。
第一个是美国会继续阻挠别的国家加入亚投行，第二个呢是对亚投行视而不见，然后第三个是美国自己改变主意了，要申请加入亚投行。
For the U.S. itself, which I think was the leader in setting up some of the other institutions, like the World Bank and the IMF, I think they may look at things and say, well, monies that are going to this entity won't be going to these other ones because there's only so much money. It can't go everywhere. And so I think that may be one of the issues.
Yeah.
Involved with their decisions, which are never lifetime decisions. But I think it is clear that there will be many, many people benefiting from the infrastructure bank.
刚才 Steve 的那个讲的那个理由，很硬的一个理由是因为他们的钱不多，就那么多啊，投了这儿就没有投了那儿，这本身不符合资本的逻辑，他还是不看好，这个你的投资的能力啊，或者说他还有别的利益的考虑，那这一个态度和立场，短时间是很难改变的。
本来这个世界银行。包括这个亚投行，它本来就不是一个纯的财务投资的这样一个工具，它是世界的各个国家希望通过这样一个基金的方式来影响世界各方面的建设呀、发展等等之类的。所以从这个意义上，美国不希望中国唱主角，这点是非常明显的，我觉得。那么我的答案是，美国继续阻扰其他国家意义不大了，它最亲密的盟友。英国、德国等等都已经进来了第二视而不见是不是美国的风格？他绝对不会视而不见，所以我觉得 A 和 C 之间嘛，甚至美国有可能说，既然我阻扰不了，那我就加入进去来影响它的管理，影响它的治理，使它更透明，更标准化。我觉得这个反而是更积极的一个做法。
美国呢，现在的态度在 A 向 B 的转变，但我觉得。如果给足够的长的时间，他会选择 C， 因为在这么一个有个时代背景，在这么一个时代里，这就像当年苹果的操作系统和那个微软的操作系统的区别一样，只有开放的世界，你通过阻挠是不可以的。
其实这是一个大势所趋，你觉得？
中国参加了美国主导的，甚至 ADB 日本主导的所有的这种金融系统，所以我觉得反过来去阻挠，它不是大势所趋。
我觉得最有可能的还是 C， 第三个选择就是美国会加入这个亚投行的这个组织。为什么呢？因为美国到目前为止啊，发现他们的之前的一些战略都搞错了。比如说对 IMF 的改革，美国人始终反对，在全球是丢分的。现在可能会转向 C， 就是说我们加入中国倡导的这些协议，在这个中国的协议框架下发挥美国的作用。所以我觉得中国方面应该做好准备，就是在这个新的组织里面如何跟美国进一步的对话，进一步的把中国的立场跟美国的立场能够统一起来。
I don't think the Asian Investment Bank has the priority of dealing with some of the other foreign policy issues, whether that's instability in the Middle East.Whether it's problems in the Ukraine. And I think part of what may be going on is simply the bandwidth of the people who have to make decisions are being pulled in a variety of ways. My sense is that without knowing anything, this will be put to the side for a while.As the U.S. deals with these other types of issues, and then perhaps a new administration will come back with this.
其实他这个观点很有代表性。美国的经济界，尤其是投资者，华尔街投资者是非常看好中国的亚投行这个项目的。但是美国的政治跟他的经济出现了脱钩。美国的政府啊，现在呢，被他的政治所左右。仍然是举棋不定，美国政府呢，他是想阻拦中国这么一个倡议，从而呢能够逐步的恢复美国在国际政治中的主导作用，就是来修补他华尔街这个2008年危机后的一些美国的一些政治上的损失。但是呢，这个趋势是阻挡不住的。美国，我看他的投资者会呼吁美国政府要加入中国，我估计政策不变。
在亚洲的各个国家当中啊，中国常常也会有一些 特别出色的一些表现，比如说至少在这个股市的表现上，我们中国还是很红火的。在现在中国股市的这个节点上，我想请教一下几位，你们觉得我们是该继续留着呢，还是我们现在就得赶紧走了呢？
本周五，中国股市创下近7年来的新高，仅今年第一季度只有728万新股民疯狂入市。但是在中国股市4000点关口，投资者究竟该何去何从？苏世民同样经历过股市的腥风血雨，黑石的股价一度从2007年的38美元暴跌至3.4美元。这位善于保持耐心、等待时机的华尔街之王，将如何判断中国股市？现场嘉宾又为何给出不平的逆转？
那有可能还会往上走一阵儿，
不会太刺激，
还是有一定潜力继续前进。
广告之后，请继续收听。
Well, I'm not a Chinese stock market expert. I've seen it go way up. I've seen it go way down. I'm seeing it go way up again. My instinct is, although I have investments in the Chinese stock market myself, through some money managers, that this is, it's a volatile, market, and it's best handled by experts, not by people like me, from the outside world.
中国股市整体来说确实涨了不少。这是有一个大背景，就中国政府愿意宽松这个态度，给股市打了一个强心针。假如缺乏这样一个经济的这个基本面的背景的话，我觉得这个股市就是看人气、看资金能推多久了。在某些小股票，什么创业板，我们的创业板相当于一个科技板。都90倍市盈率以上了，我觉得，所以有些小股票泡沫性还是有点大，但是泡沫很难预测它什么时候结束，它有可能还会往上走一阵儿。
对，
所以我觉得到这个层面上已经是一种心理的游戏了。
所以刚才黄教授分析的还是比较对的，因为在股市它运行的规律跟实体经济它肯定是不一样的地方，它有大量的心理的行为经济学的那些逻辑在里头。所以我觉得日子能持续多久不能准确的预测，但是它这种多方面的外在因素刺激下的这种增长不会太持久。
我倒提点不同的观点，我觉得这一轮的股市的上涨呢，第一呢得益于大盘的上涨，主要是蓝筹股的这个回调。第二呢，这是得益于整体上讲，大家看到了新的一轮公司治理的一些改进的苗头。公司治理的改进，当然我们都知道很重要的一条法治，正在法治上的改革在全面推进。另外呢，现在这一轮呢，我们的上涨还有一个因素，就是国外的估值打通了。沪港通马上推出来的这个深港通，就是让大家看到国外的估值比较高，已经涨了两三年了，我们过去两三年是跌的，所以实际上有一个国内国外估值的一个对价的过程，所以我倒认为呢，这一轮的至少是大盘的股还是有一定潜力继续前进的。
但是这一轮行情确实让很多人都挣到了钱，因为在中国现在有一个词叫互联网加，就是任何一个行业只要跟互联网沾上一点边，它似乎都会生机勃勃，都会给你带来无限的畅想。但是呢，这个局面我要告诉各位，其实是苏世民先生特别不感兴趣的，因为我看了一下他的这个投资，几乎从来没有在互联网方面有过大手笔的投资吧。
We don't have that knowledge base. And as a result of that, we would be more like me too investors. When I wake up in the morning and I pull up my iPad and I look at all those wonderful applications and I can do this from airplanes. It's amazing technology. You can be flying around the world, emailing people anywhere in the world, and they will just instantly get back to you. Who could imagine? I look at that and I say, geez, I wish we were doing that. And perhaps the next generation of people at Blackstone will be doing it. I don't have that genius, that expertise, and we haven't been able to find it.
我刚才在节目录像之前注意到了一个细节， 就是我们俩在聊的时候，Steve 接了一个电话，你们猜一下他拿出来的电话是什么样的电话？有兴�去看吗？我们调查一下，超过90%的人想看，我们就提出一个申请，看 Steve 愿不愿意展现一下他的手机。
Well, I get a lot of laughter when I bring out my cell phone. It's actually a funny story on this. I usually keep it on all the time, and I was in Korea, and I was having a lunch with a fellow named Jay Lee, who runs the electronics business at Samsung, and his sister, because their father was the head of Samsung, and my phone started ringing, and it was my wife. So I picked it up and I said hello, and Jay and his sister started laughing, and I couldn't figure out where they were laughing, but it was, and Jay said, he said, what kind of museum did you go to where you took this phone? He said, because they don't sell them anymore. And he said, why would you ever have a phone like this? He said, I'll give you a phone. I make some of the best phones in the world. So I said, well, I like this because it has big numbers. And I don't have to swipe anything. And it's 2G technology, which works everywhere in the world. And I was just someplace in the Caribbean with my wife yesterday, and she could not use her phone, which was one of these modern phones, actually it was a Samsung, in certain locations where she said, can you please dial on your phone? And it got through every time. I like the reliability, but there's almost no one who does not laugh at me with that phone.
我想不用调查，我都可以猜测出你应该是全场唯一一个还在使用非触摸屏的非智能手机的人。我估计你回到美国之后，库克一定会约你吃午餐，他一定要把你这个重要的客户攻下来啊，让你下一回拿出一个智能手机来。但其实我也很担心啊，你像这个手机现在在市面上卖的并不多了，这万一它电池出现点问题啊，或者其他的这些故障出现的话，有的时候你都找不到维修的地方啊，你不担心吗？
Well, if my cell phone doesn't work, I'll have to move into the modern world. I'll learn to do it. But I don't like the size in my pocket. And, actually somebody told me you can't get rid of the swiping if you want. So at some point I'll give up, but I like it. It's like having an old friend.
一个很念旧很长情的人，手机或者是互联网行业显然不是黑石更愿意去触碰的一个领域。我们来谈一谈你们更愿意或者准确的说更擅长的一个领域，那就是房地产的投资。大家都知道黑石是全美个人住宅最大的一个拥有者。2014年前九个月，黑石的获利当中45%都是来自房地产领域，这个你就一点都不觉得奇怪了。但是奇怪的是，在这个过程当中，其实你对中国的房地产市场一直不太感冒。我查了一下这个资料哈，大概2010年你出手了，2012年也出手了，都在上海。但是 Steve 去年就公开表示说，我已经不再对中国的房地产市场感兴趣了，我也不想再去投了。
I think what I was saying, if I said that, is really certain parts of the China real estate area, like residential, look like they were, sort of a bit overbought. But there are other parts of China real estate that we think are going to do very well. There are certain areas in retail, as the Chinese middle class continues to develop, that'll be very good things to own. As I mentioned before, the warehouse area, logistics, is going to be very good. So you can't just paint China with one brush. That would be a mistake.
确切地说，是对中国的住宅市场不感兴趣了。
确实，像 Steve 所说，整个房地产不能以单一的住宅或者单一的商业地产来看，它是一个比较复杂的一个行业。刚好万科跟黑石，合作开发物流地产，也是因为，第一呢，黑石其实在美国和欧洲有大量的仓储和物流地产，或者是工业地产，在一个大的品类叫工业地产。同时呢，因为黑石它投资的纪律非常的高，有非常严格的投资纪律。同时，因为黑石呢也有非常多的这样的经验，所以对万科来讲，进入这么一个新兴的领域，需要一个很好的一个 gatekeeper， 有一个守门员，告诉我们哪些共同去投资，哪些不共同投资。
主持人好，各位嘉宾好，我是中国经济周刊的记者。如果呢，我是一个投资性住宅的这个持有者来说，那么现在我是不是到了一个卖房的时机？我这个问题呢，也想提给这个李道葵教授和这个 Steve Schwab 先生，就是说，我想请您对比一下，就北京、上海的这样的房价和纽约这样的大城市，然后另外就是现在如果是投资性住宅的话，是不是到了卖的时候？谢谢。
I really don't know whether you should be selling an apartment or not here. I think in China, and I'm not the expert on apartments. We have people at the firm who know that. So.You know, there are much different supply-demand requirements all over China. And so I'm going to have to reluctantly pass on the answer to this question.
我认为至少在短期内我们看到了很多上涨的一个趋势，但是房价暴涨的可能性确实是，我觉得这个时代过去了。我们对整个房地产市场的看法是，住宅市场是黄金时代到白银时代。那么只能说这个房地产整个行业的获利，它会不再像以前远远超过资金成本。所以这是一个时代的判断。但是我觉得只要是人口不断增加的城市，城市化进程没有结束。只要是供应比较稀缺的城市，我觉得相对来说机会会更多一点，但对大量供应的城市和人口流入不断减少的城市，我觉得要比较谨慎。
其实从黑石成立的第一天开始，Schwarzman 先生跟他的合伙人就一直秉持着谨慎的风格，所以刚才大家看到了，他说自己对中国的住宅市场不是那么了解，所以他不能轻易的给出一些建议。但是你一定对美国的住宅市场更了解，所以我们接下来来看一看美国的住宅市场。我在媒体上找到了这样的两张照片啊，因为这个照片当中会让很多人心动。来，我们看看第一张，这是有的网站最新推荐的夏日海滨之城。这样的一套别墅是工匠风格，它是独栋的，它是带游泳池的，然后它的售价是46.49万美金，大概约合人民币300万左右吧，哈。那这样的一个房子呢，如果你在北京，你手中有同样的钱，你可能只能买到这样的比较老旧的小区当中的某一套房子。所以现在很多的中国人正用很大的热情把钱搬到美国去，要去投资美国的住宅市场。
What's very funny is my mother used to live in Cape May, New Jersey.
Wow.
So the U.S. is a pretty big place. So to pick a place where my mother lived, that's pretty clever. Houses there are not very expensive. And they're not very expensive because it's basically a vacation type community for older people. It's not real exciting. I don't know about the relative value of those two locations. It seems to be much nicer to be in a nice house, but if you need to have a job and, you know, you're not near any place, then that doesn't work so well.
现在美国的房价其实还在往上涨，很多的中国投资者在问自己，我要不要去美国买房子？我的想法是呢，绝大部分的老百姓，中国的百姓，中国投资者，去美国买房子是很困难的，不应该这么考虑这个问题，因为买房子交易成本非常高。但是呢，如果有条件，可以考虑投资于美国的与房地产相关的一些企业的股票或者它金融资产，这样子可以搭上他们美国房价上涨的顺风车。
其实一段时间以来，关于在美国买房的新闻特别特别的多。大家一定听到过美国纽约的华尔道夫酒店被出售的这个消息，对吧？买主呢是吴晓辉先生，也是安邦的董事长。他自己认为他自己的这个投资是非常合算的一个投资。他说：“你看，如果我们在北京的金融街要去买，这个一平米呢大概要10万块钱，但是你的使用权呢是40年。但是我到美国去买了纽约的华尔道夫酒店，算下来呢每平米大概是7万块钱人民币。所以你一算，而且这个使用权是终身的嘛
啊。” I think the Waldorf is a very famous hotel in New York and has moved in 2 or 3 different locations over the last 150 years. And it takes up a whole city block in New York, right in the best area. And I think that could be a successful investment. Their plans aren't to just leave it the way it is. They're going to be modernizing it. They're going to be thinking about making some changes to make it into apartments for some of it, for people to have for themselves, and the rest of it will be a modernized hotel. So if they execute that plan in a good way, that should be a successful investment for them.
现在中国很多投资者都想到美国投资，那么能不能给我们中国投资者一个最重要的一个建议
？For investors in the U.S. right now, we have a stock market that's pretty high. We have interest rates that are very low. So I do think there's one area besides technology, which we talked about, that's very interesting, and that's the energy area. The U.S. is now going to be the largest producer of oil and gas in the world. That's sort of a lucky accident of where you happen to be. And we happen to be in a place that's very rich with that. Now, the price of energy, because the U.S. is producing so much of it, has collapsed. It's down about 50% for both, particularly oil. And gas has gone down dramatically also. So a lot of companies are having trouble. Despite the fact they're finding a lot, the cost of doing it, the margin has gone down because the prices have gone down 50%. So there are terrific opportunities now in the United States to take advantage of that decline.
房地产一直是黑石最为青睐的投资项目，而黑石历史上最成功的一笔投资就是260亿美元杠杆收购希尔顿酒店集团。近两年，黑石成立了130亿美元的全球房地产基金，成为全球房地产的最大买家。今年已经68岁的苏世民依然亲自掌管着这个私募帝国，而外界最大的好奇就是谁能成为黑石的新接班人。苏世民也将教育子女看作一种投资，但是这种投资却与作为华尔街之王以往的投资风格大不相同。
据我们了解，您的孩子是以不同的方式现在做得非常的出色，能不能跟我们的中国的父母分享一下，在你教育儿子的过程中，哪一两件事情你觉得做得非常对？
其实我很意外哈，李教授除了关心经济还关心育儿经啊。我给大家再看一个电影海报，这次这个电影海报跟华尔街没什么关系了，但是跟奥斯卡有关系。这是刚刚揭晓的这一届奥斯卡的金像奖当中获得最佳剧本改编奖的电影《模仿游戏》。这部电影的制片人，注意哦，他的名字叫泰迪·施瓦兹曼，这就是 Steve 施瓦兹曼先生的儿子。
好厉害啊
！Geez, nothing makes a parent happier than the happiness of their children. And as children get older, you remember them from when they just were born. I remember when my son was born, I tried to remember what size he was. So we have a game in America called football. It's not like soccer that you play. And I remember holding my son in one hand and his feet went there and I could carry him around the house like a football. So now he's 35 years old. And when he went to college in the United States and then went to law school where he met his wife and joined a law firm. And after 2 years, he didn't like it. So he came to me and he said, I don't like my job. It's boring. And I want to change. And I said, what do you want to do? So he said, I want to join this little company that represents actors and actresses and directors and puts together movie packages. So I said, well, what do they want to pay you? He said, well, they don't want to pay me anything. I said, but you were making like $400,000 a year, and these people don't want to pay you anything. He said, well, they like me. I said, people who like people and don't pay them anything, they actually don't like them that much. So I said, you got to get paid something. So I said, ask him for like $40,000. He said, Dad, they don't want to do it. So he asked them, and they didn't want to do it. And I said, well, just tell them you can't work for nothing. It's undignified. So he ended up getting, I think it was $20,000 a year. So he did it for 2 years. And after 2 years, he said, he came to see me, and he said, I want to go into business for myself. So he needed some capital. So, you know, we gave him some capital. And I said, look, the movie business is treacherous business in the United States. First, 80% of movies don't make money. So you're in a business that's a loser, right? Secondly, nobody knows why they don't make money, which is even worse, okay? Or else they would solve that problem. So, and third, there are a lot of the people who are not honest, and they talk fast, and they just try and steal your money. I said, you should consider at the beginning just lending money as most senior obligation. The last money in, let them complete the movie and you get your money out first. And don't worry about the wonder of making movies. Just make sure the definition of success financially in the movie business is having the same amount of money in 5 years that you start with. I said, don't worry about making some big success. And so he did that for a while and then got experience. And then he came on a script of a movie called The Imitation Game, which is about an inventor named, a mathematician named Alan Turing.
That's what you're doing here, the top secret program at Bletchley. You're trying to break the German Enigma machine.
I went on the set of the movie when they were filming it because I wanted to meet Keira Knightley because she was so pretty. So I met, you know, they would go around and I didn't have a name. My only identity was Teddy's father, right? Done. for those of you in the audience, if you can help your child, support them, and have them create a success that gives them pleasure, gives them ownership of their own life, it's for a parent, it's about the most wonderful feeling you could ever have.
谈到您教育您的儿子的时候呢，啊，你其实更多的是在欣赏。假如你有更多的儿子，或者说您给一个您的朋友，像比如说我们如何在跟孩子的相处当中提高他的财商？这是现在我们中国是比较有钱，但我们的财商是比较低的。作为我也是一个，我有一个儿子，我如何去跟他进行一个比较好的一个财商的教育，至少说可以给他一些提醒。
I faced that same problem myself because I had a daughter, and so what I wanted to, for her was the best education possible. So she went to very good preparatory schools and went to Yale University, where I went.And then I asked her to do me a favor, which she wasn't sure what graduate school she wanted to go to. So I asked her to go to Harvard Business School. She was almost the only liberal arts person there. She got a very interesting education and ended up being a writer on their newspaper because she's very good at writing.There needs to be education in school systems so that you know that. And then parents have to spend the time to explain to their children how certain things in the world work. Keeping people in the dark is a bad idea. And so I've spent a lot of time with my children, and now my next challenge our grandchildren, but fortunately they're young enough that I've got seven of them so far that I don't have to be teaching them yet because the oldest one is seven. But the time will come where you know I'll have to teach them the basics. Everyone should know the basics. Then they do with their life whatever they want.
我们正在寻找这样的人。他们创新，无视既有的规则。
阿里人必须看到后天的太阳。
要创新，挑战，打破巨头的垄断。
要做失败率高的事，要做别人不敢做的事。
他们坚持理想，无论他人如何评价。他们从不安于现状，梦想改造世界。他们也许将光环满身。
I'm the king of the world。
他们也许会一败涂地。你可以赞美他们，追随他们，也可以质疑他们，否定他们。
开始，开始，开始！
但你无法无视他们，因为他们的尝试
对于我们来说，这是一个全新的世界。
他们的思想改变了这个世界。对话，向那些疯狂的人致敬。
谢谢 Schwarzman 来到我们对话节目现场。其实围绕着他躲不开的一个字儿就是钱，而且大家一定也发现了，在今天节目的现场，他也从来没有掩饰过自己对于创造财富的一份热爱。其实我觉得创造财富、成就自己、回报社会，这是每一个人都应该努力去追寻的一个方向。虽然在中国，很多人提到挣钱都会讳莫如深，但是中国也有句老话。君子爱财，取之有道。如果你挣的是阳光下的钱，其实完全不必有任何的心理障碍。好，再次用掌声谢谢 Skip Schwarzman 先生来到对话现场，谢谢我们在座的各位，谢谢大家，再见。